And the customer, yeah.
And the customer, in fact, the Sunai data is available right there on site. You can do editing to simulate trees being cut down. It's a very important tool for showing customers why you're making the decisions you are on site.
I've been out on many, many site evaluations, and I've actually shown them the shade data, and they get very excited about this. They see that they have good production, or if they have to trim some trees back, but they do get very excited to see the actual data on a professional tool. And I've actually competed against people that didn't have a professional tool, and it's been very successful that they get to see what you're doing.
And one of the most common, complaints that the end solar customers have is that when during the planning phase or during the sales phase, a edit was made to simulate a tree being gone, and then when the system gets installed, the tree is still there, and that caused a mismatch of expectations. So it's important to address that, early in the process. So this is going back into the CPF tool for a minute. This is the site visit where Chris left off, and I'm just going to go through it again real quickly using a specific example. And this is the measurement tool here, and that will bring up this aerial photo. But before I get to that, actually, there's a little document within the tool here that's a nice thing to take out on site if you have a clipboard or a tablet computer or whatever. You can document, this document actually has a lot of the key things that you need to do other than shade. It's, what's the customer details, the conduit run length, the roof condition, all the things, and a little area for a map of the roof that you can draw. All those things are documented in a nice little two-page document or three-page document that is very helpful.
So it's kind of even its own little best practices for site evaluation built in the tool. You just have to hit print and bring it with you. Oh, that's awesome.
So let's go to this measurement tool again. And this is actually my home, so I'll just use that as an example. From the aerial photo, you can map out the area of the roof. And you'll notice I don't have solar yet, so I'm inviting your proposals today. But you can see here over on the right side here is the length and width and area of the roof, as well as the azimuth of the roof, which is the direction that the tilt points it. And as Chris mentioned, you enter in the tilt and you can see that. Now, when you actually get to the site, relating this aerial picture to what's in reality is always a useful and sometimes challenging endeavor. So measure azimuth, measure area. Okay, this shows what my home looks like from the street, and so you can see this surface here is this roof surface I've measured here. Notice there are some things that you can't tell from the aerial view, like this tree, which actually is growing quickly. There's this chimney up here that could cause shade. There's a great big tree over here that could cause some shade actually on this side of the roof, that morning kind of shade that I showed earlier. And so you see a lot when you're on site, even if you're not on the roof, you see a lot that you can now inform your decisions and how you treat the site. And what I tell people is the best sort of way to get the overall feel is to be able to look south or be the roof and look south, face to the left. That's going to be east. You're going to see potential for morning shade that way. Look straight ahead, that's going to be day, the middle of the day shade. Is the sun going to manage to make it over the things that are, potential obstructions? And then look right or west for the afternoon shade and what if any trouble you're going to have. The afternoon is where you get the valuable production with the time of use. So in many cases, you want to really optimize for afternoon production. So then if you do have access to the roof, and in some cases you won't, we'll talk about that in a minute, but if you do have access to the roof, using this site survey mode where the Sunai actually, you can walk around, the sun path is just as you do walk around, you can see the compass and level readings there, and you can actually put a little window there to identify a time and month window. For example, this window shows, I think it's 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. All year round, and just see what shade is getting within that window that you might be extra concerned about the production, and you know, trying to stay as shade-free as possible within that window so you can walk around and do sort of that preliminary site survey.
So what would it say to an installer person using, should they trim those trees? What is the action item? If you saw this reading, what should they do?
Well, if you're concerned about any of these things, you could talk about this tree here. In this case, that may or may not belong to you, though. That might be your neighbor's tree, and so there's times when you don't have that option. So that might mean you need to scoot back a little bit, take a reading. Obviously, never walk backwards on a roof. You know, that's one of the rules of safety. But you want to maybe back off or go to the, in this case, go east, because that tree is to the west. Go east. That'll take you away from that tree and be a better production area. Now, you do have, some cases where you want to minimize this, reduce the size of your system, or put your system in a higher production area, or use higher efficiency modules on a smaller area of the roof. Those are all approaches that you might take. So just jump to the next slide here. I'll try to jump to the next slide. Okay. So the next thing is again going back to sort of the best practices is the process of taking measurements, actually recording the measurements. And this is where you might want to take readings around the corners. You know, there's some specific things that your state rebate program might require, your company may require, your financial partner may require, but these are the rules of thumb. Every 15 feet or so, you should be logical in how you take the data. For example, I started in the lower left here with number one and went counterclockwise around the area or potential area. Depending on where you are in that life cycle, you may or may not know precisely where the models are going to go yet, but do something logical, record your location, make a map, and try to get the worst case location so that you have a conservative estimate of the shade.
So I see on here you have actual six readings for this job. Is that a recommended process that people should go through?
Yeah, It's not necessarily six readings, but you want to capture the corners. And what I say is, you don't want to go too far. Like if you have 40 feet from one end to the other, you might want to take a reading in between. That would be 20 feet. California requires that you have at least a reading every 40 feet around the perimeter. But you could, I think a best practice is more like 15 feet as I put here. But it's up to you and your company. I also recommend putting a reading at the location on the perimeter of the roof which is closest to the obstruction. So if you have a tree, that's out here on the on this side, you may want to take a reading that's closest to get that worst case. Because the worst thing is to have a customer or an inspector come and measure a shade and have it be worse than what you showed in your measurements.
Okay. Don't just stand in the middle and hit the button.
There are some cases where you can do that, and particular, if there's no shade anywhere and you're just doing the preliminary, you can't. There's not a tree in sight. You may want to just take one, but generally people are taking six or eight on a typical residential roof.
Great.
So this is for those of you who may not be familiar with the sun eye. The sun eye is basically a fancy camera with a fisheye lens and a compass and level built into it. It has an optional GPS in it. And it calculates the sun path and lets you take pictures of the sky.
So tell me about the new GPS feature. What is going on with that? Why would someone want that?
So the GPS would allow you to, first of all, identify your location easily so that you would be able to calculate, so the sun path will be calculated accurately. But the other thing it does is it allows you to record the exact GPS location of every skyline that you take. The skyline is what we call the sky pictures, the fisheye pictures. Each one of those skylines gets geotagged, and so you have the exact coordinates of the GPS measurement in that recorded with the report. And we actually have a way that I'll show you in a minute to output that to Google Earth, so you can look in that same picture. It's similar to the picture that we showed earlier with the aerial view. You can identify where those readings have been taken.
Great.
So when you're capturing the skyline, you want to basically, it's a three-step process. You point it south, you hold it level, and you press the button. It's kind of just like taking a picture with a camera. And one thing that people sometimes get confused at is to hold it south and level. This is very important. So you notice here that this gentleman is not putting the device along the slope of the roof. He's not pointing it along the azimuth of the roof. He's pointing it south, which goes at an angle to the roof, and he's holding it level, and that's always important. And you can see the indications here. You get a visual indication. It's kind of like a video game. You can actively see south and level, and as long as it turns yellow in the indicators here, you're good to go. You can press the snap button and take the photo.
And the level in the tube is now digital?
That's right. And there's a pretty wide window here. It's like 5 degrees plus or minus on the level and plus or minus 15 degrees on the azimuth. And the measurements will actually be automatically corrected for that error. So that does allow you to be a little quicker and less worried about holding it exactly correct. We still recommend holding it approximately correct. So this is a little checklist that your business partners or your management team might want to think about is when the system comes back to the office and you download it to your computer, people are going to be checking, is the location marked correctly, is the time zone right. There are time of day labels on the sun paths here. These are time of day, so you got to make sure the time zone is correct. If you have session summaries, like the solar access summaries and multiple skylines, is that done correctly? Are the obstructions identified correctly? The obstructions are always shown in green, open sky in yellow. The photographer here should never be in the sun path, so that would cause an error in the reading. The panel tilt and azimuth need to be accurately entered here for what the roof is, and if there's an inconsistency between what's here and what's in your, for example, your CPF tools documentation, you're going to raise a red flag. And lastly, if the sun is present, you know, people ask, you know, hey, what's the dot in my picture? It's messing up my picture. Well, that is where the sun oversaturates the camera. If the sun is present, it's a convenient sort of calibration or double check. You can see this measurement was made at 14 o'clock, which is 2 p.m., and in the middle of February. These are the 21st of each month. The show's February. It's a little small there. Sorry for that. But there's a time and date stamp right up here in each skyline, and you can compare that to where the sun actually was, and it makes a cross check. So that's another way people check.
A lot of people ask me, is there a best time to take these readings? Should it be high noon, or what is the best time to take these?
There's no restriction on except that it should be daytime. It should be light outside. But if you have enough light, you will have enough light to basically capture a single photo, and it shows you the solar access for the whole year with that single photo. And in some conditions, if it's really bright, you can have some issues with how the image gets captured and so you might need to do some editing afterwards. And we've tried to make some adjustments to the camera, which you can set for cloudy conditions that are really sunny conditions. But generally, any time of day works well.